morning. Welcome to Rockpoint Community Church. We're glad you're here. We're going to have a great morning of Easter worship. The Lord is risen and risen indeed. Many of us already got started this morning at 7, so we're back and ready to go. For those of you who've just getting here, this is awesome. It's going to be a great morning. And why don't I pray? Heavenly Father, we ask that you would pour out your blessing on Rockpoint, Lord. We ask that we would be pleasing to you with our worship, that you would be excited what's going on here this morning, that your name would be lifted high. We invite the Holy Spirit to make his way in our hearts and our minds so that we might grow and trust and love the risen Christ with all our hearts. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, and a very happy Easter to all of you. Welcome, and please stand and worship with us as we lift up our praise to our God.
Thank you.
looked, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessings." And heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them, saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever."
Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still, and all but alone. No praise the name. Praise him. Christ the Lord is risen today.
You may be seated. We're going to let the kids who want to go to Kids Rock head on out. So if you want to go to Kids Rock, you can do that now. All right. And as they make their way out, I want to remind you that we have the season of service coming up. And our first big event is on Saturday, April 30. We are going to go do some spring cleaning with New Hope. We'll actually do some planting, some flowers, and cleaning up the property. So we have signups in the back. We'd love for you to come out with us to be at New Hope on April 30, just for the morning hours, and we'll give them a hand to get ready for spring cleaning. So just keep that in front of your mind. And at this time, we're going to invite the deacons to come forward for the tithes and offerings. All right, great.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined upon us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, and rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. suffering, anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is here. The hand that held nations stretched out on a tree. It took the nails for me. Could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising again. Living, he loved me, dying, he saved me, buried, he carried me, my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. The trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one, bring me. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
Amen. Amen. It is a glorious day. Hallelujah. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come and we bow to you and to you alone. You are a great and awesome, mighty God. You love your people and you have a great plan of redemption. And Lord, you didn't withhold your own son for our salvation. We're here today to remember and to celebrate what Christ went through for every one of us. To celebrate that he came up out of that grave and now we have the hope of life, that not even death can hold us down. Lord Jesus, praise you. Bless you. Your name is worthy of all the praise. We could never give the amount of praise and worship that you are worthy of and you deserve, but we're going to do the best we can this morning, and we praise you, God. Lord, we know that we're sinners. We're not perfect. But Lord God, you have forgiven us of all our sins, past, present, future. You know that we couldn't do salvation by our own strength and our own merit, Lord, so you did it for us. You are a God of grace, and you give this great gift. We receive it, Jesus. We receive it with open hearts and open minds because we're so grateful for you. Please forgive us. And I pray that on this Easter, Lord, we would not live in any kind of spirit of shame or guilt, Lord God, but we would be free because you have freed us. And I pray that we would just turn our attention more and more to you, oh God, that we would be changed increasingly into the glory of Christ, like Paul writes in 2 Corinthians. Heavenly Father, we have a lot to be excited about. God, I want to give you praise and thanks for the arrival of Maylee Lane and Gwen Olivia to Ian and Melanie Zacharias. We praise God for these babies that were born and for giving Melody the strength, Lord Jesus. And we pray also a praise for Alyssa and John and the arrival of Grant Matthew in their home. Lord, there is just so much new life and there is so much joy for us to be celebrating here at Rockpoint. Of course, we pray for those who need your healing touch. And I pray for Linda Vogel that her double vision would go away completely, that she'd be fully restored and quickly, Lord God. We bless her, we cherish her as a sister at this church. And we pray for Marge Van Hook. Lord, we know she's just got such a righteous spirit and she's so faithful and she's been coming for so long, but she can't be here right now. And I pray that you give her the strength to get through rehab and to get out of the Christian Healthcare Center and to be back worshiping with us. And I think of John Dyke, Lord. Give him strength. We thank you for all you have done for him, how you've sustained him, Lord Jesus. Pray for Phyllis, Lord God, that you would continue to just pour out your love on her. And all those who can't be with us this morning, we praise you for how you've sustained Jim Opperly and continue to give his body strength in the midst of his cancer, Lord God. You keep preserving him, and we thank you and praise you, Lord. He is a dear brother to us here. Heavenly Father, I pray for the upcoming season of service, that we would fill up every trip and every outing that we want to do, Lord God, not because it's just something we should do, but because, Lord, we want to care better for one another. And this is an opportunity to get out there and to love people, Lord Jesus. You know, Lord, when we love you and love others, it's actually healthier for ourselves. And when we serve and think about others, it takes our mind off of ourselves, Lord God, and that is freeing. Your ways are true. Your ways are always right. And we give you praise and thanks for all of this. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus had sent his disciples to go get some food. And while they went in looking for food, Jesus was really thirsty as he had been traveling out through the wilderness near Samaria, and he came across a well. And there was a woman at this well, and he said to this lady, "Excuse me, would you give me some water to drink?" Now, this woman was very taken back because she was from Samaria, and she says to him, "I am quite surprised that you would speak to me. Not only am I a woman, but I'm a woman of Samaria, and you're a Jewish man. You really shouldn't be doing this." But Jesus said to her, "If you knew who it was that was asking you for a drink, you'd ask him for a drink, and I would give you living water." Of course, the woman wants to know about this living water. I mean, which woman would typically come out in the middle of the day, the heat of the day, to draw water? Well, we know this woman has a story. But Jesus says to her, "I would have given you living water right off the spot. You know, no questions asked." So she says, "Well, then I want this kind of water. Because if we drink from the well, you're going to be thirsty again," Jesus says. "But if you drink my water, you will never thirst again." "Well, then I want that water." He says, "Well, okay, go tell your husband and come back, bring them, and we'll all have this water." So she says, "Well, I don't have a husband." And Jesus reveals that he's aware she has had five. And the person she is now living with is not her husband. And she's taken back again. She recognizes he has to be at least some sort of prophet. And what's so amazing about this story is that Jesus enters into her life knowing all the stuff about her past and yet said before he revealed her sins, if you had asked me for this living water, I would have given it to you. This is a grace-made turnaround story. Have you ever been in a situation where you could really need a God turnaround? Anybody? Anybody need a turnaround? Well, happy Easter. This is the resurrection story. It is the greatest turnaround story event in the history of history, right? In history. There you go. And I hope this is your story today. So let's listen in and let's worship God through the reading of Mark 15 and 16. So turn with me to the end of Mark 15, and we are going to just tap in to a whole bunch of grace-made turnaround stories, and of course, the greatest one is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So we're going to be in Mark chapter 15. We'll start there to set us up for 16, and we'll go to from verse 42. And when evening had come, since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself looking for the kingdom of God, took courage. And he went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was surprised to hear that he should have already died. And summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he was already dead. And when he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the corpse to Joseph. Joseph brought a linen shroud, taking him down, wrapped him in the linen shroud, laid him in a tomb that had been cut out of the rock, and he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. Now Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of Joseph saw where he was laid. The stone has been rolled in front of the tomb. It's shut. And talk about needing a turnaround. All these dedicated disciples who had been following Jesus for the last 3 years and given up everything to run after him, believing he was the one, their God is now dead. Can't imagine how dashed they must have been and how hopeless they must have felt having gone through that terrible night. But the women had seen where he was laid and they wanted to go and properly prepare his body for burial because it wasn't properly done as Johnny mentioned this morning. Now in verse 1, surprise. When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. Very early on the first day of the week, early Sunday morning, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking back, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. How could this be possible? They entered the tomb, and they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. They were terrified. So in this story, really, we have an encounter with somebody, we have a message, and then we're given instructions. So the encounter for the women is this strange man sitting in the empty tomb. What's happening? The women show up. They're concerned how they're going to do this because, no, they can't roll away this giant stone. They get there, and to their utter surprise, the stone has been rolled away, and they enter in. Now, it's kind of awkward when you go into an ancient Israelite tomb at this time. I don't really know how the scene went down. The Bible doesn't describe it. But typically, what you would do is you would go past the rock, you know, pull the rock away, and there is an antechamber. And at the back of the antechamber, they typically would just cut out a 2-foot-high doorway, which they would slide the body into and leave it in the back, which was the burial chamber, which was about 6 to 7 foot square and about the same high. It's like a perfect cube almost. I was kind of just picturing like what it must have been like for these women to get there. They're shocked to find this stone rolled away. Then they have to crawl through this 2-foot door and they get in, and to their utter surprise, there is a man standing there. It's not Jesus, and he's dressed in a white robe. Now, the scriptures make it quite clear that whenever somebody comes on behalf of God, they're usually wearing white and they're angelic beings. And so the white robe would indicate to us that this was not a typical man. This was definitely an angelic being. Even Johnny mentioned that this morning. The angels were always sent for messages, right? Or for war. They are unbelievable beings. Now, maybe he was a little bit he must have been quite terrifying. When they saw the men, they were terrified. So let's just go with the word terrified, because that's really what it means when it says they were alarmed. The word alarmed there really means they were terrified. They were shook to the core. I know my grandmother used to tell us ghost stories when we were little, and all her, you know, spiritual encounters. And I would always think, man, that would be really cool. And then you start having dreams about it, and you think, heck no. I like the fact that God keeps the supernatural behind the scene here, because I think if I have an encounter, I might just freak out. It's unbelievable. But what this tells us with the encounter of this man who's wearing the white robe, the scriptures are setting up for us, and the fact that the women are terrified means this isn't just a regular guy sitting in there. It's a powerful angelic being. They come in, and they're about to get a message that is of divine significance. What this angel has to say is going to be a big deal. And as I mentioned already, this is the greatest grace-made turnaround event in history. So what's the message? Verse 6. He said to these ladies, he said, come here, do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth. He was crucified, he has risen, he is not here. See the place where they have laid him. You seek Jesus of Nazareth. He was crucified, but he has risen, and he's not here. Come take a look, I'll show you. What a message. But you know what? Sometimes it's so easy for us to hear something or see something multiple times without it sinking in. Have you ever had that? Or even drive by a house and all of a sudden they cut down the front plants and all of a sudden you're like, I never noticed that house before. You know, but you don't pay attention. Or you could even come in and you know, we got these great songs and you can sing a bunch of songs and then you're like, wait, what did we sing again? Okay. But we need to pay close attention. And we need to make sure that what God is saying to us sinks in. Because for the disciples, Jesus had been saying all along what was going to happen, and something wasn't sinking in. They needed God's help for it to sink in. It's good news. We need God's help too for these things to sink in. And so that's why we pray and we ask. But I want to go back and just take a look in Mark at all the times Jesus told them what was going to happen. All right? So if you want, we're going to just stay in Mark. You can follow me or you can just listen. I'm fine either way. We're going to go back to Mark chapter 8, because there's 5 instances where Jesus tells them, I am going to be turned over to the scribes and the Pharisees. They are going to reject me. They're going to beat me. They're going to kill me. And on the 3rd day, I will rise. Chapter 8, verse 31. He began to teach his disciples that the Son of Man must, here we go, suffer many things. He will be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes. He will be killed, and after 3 days, he will rise again. He said this plainly. Yet Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter. Said, get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. We so often think our ways and our perspective are right. But God has the perfect perspective. And he makes the most sense, yet his plan might take an entirely different route than we would have imagined. And I have to imagine that had to be true for the disciples. Here they were following him, thinking, this is it, baby. We're going to be rulers with the King of Kings. And he's talking about death. We're not really into that part. So we're going to skip it, Lord. And Peter actually goes so far as to rebuke him. But what Jesus's response tells us is this, and this is really a question for all of us. Do you trust God's route? That's a big part of this resurrection story. If you're putting your faith in Jesus, you're saying, I trust Jesus's route. We don't really trust a lot of people here in North Jersey. That's not a big thing for us. We're not super trusting people. You know, we're not like cuddly bunch. So, usually we think somebody's got something on us or something like that. But here comes Jesus and he's saying, I need you to trust me whatever route I'm going to take you down. That's faith. Now look at verse 9. Disciples still aren't getting this. Again, they're going to need God's help. Good news. They get God's help. We're going to get God's help. And as they were coming down the mountain, he charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Now they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead might even mean. Chapter 9, verse 30. They went on from there and they passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know. For he was teaching his disciples, saying them, the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him. And when he is killed, after 3 days, he will rise again. But they did not understand the saying, and they were afraid to ask him. Now, this is great here because immediately they switch to a discussion they're having amongst themselves after Jesus just told them, I'm going to die. It's going to be rough. And they switch again the topic to, well, who's going to be the greatest in your kingdom? So clearly this is just not sinking in at all, or maybe they just don't want to hear the whole message. And so they switch the topic and they talk about who will be the greatest. Chapter 10, verse 32. They were on the road and they were going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them, and they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. And taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what was about to happen. See, we are going up to Jerusalem. The Son of Man will be delivered over the chief priests and the scribes. They will condemn him to death, and they will deliver him over to the Gentiles, and they will mock him, spit on him, flog him, and kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise. He's trying to get the message out there. He's making it very clear, which is great for us, because if he does rise, you can't say he didn't tell them what was coming. He's been predicting the thing the whole way. He must know what he's talking about. He must be God. Now, the crazy thing is, as soon as he says this, what happens? Now, James and John, the brothers of thunder, sons of thunder and their brothers, are now arguing who's going to sit on his right and his left. So they're going back to the same conversation. Wait, we still are not really tracking with this whole message you're giving us. But when we get to this kingdom, who's on the right? Who's on the left? Who gets the best spot? They were not ready for the route Jesus was about to take. That's why this is faith. And faith really means trust. We have to trust Jesus no matter the route. Then again in chapter 14, which we read Friday night, he mentions it again in the institution of the Lord's Supper. They were eating. He took bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it. He gave it to them. He said, take this. This is my body. They still weren't comprehending that he actually meant this was to represent, now we say symbolically, the brokenness of his body. But his body would have to get crushed to fulfill this Lord's Supper. Then he took a cup. He said, listen, this is my blood, which I'm telling you, it's about to be spilled out. I'm going to die. And this blood being spilled out is to set up a new covenant, which is going to happen because of my death and my resurrection and the pouring out of my blood. And he then says, I will not drink of the vine until I drink it anew in the kingdom of heaven. So the message is pretty clear. He's setting them up so that when they experience and they see him overcoming the grave, they will know they've needed him to do this, and that this will seal the deal for the overcoming grace they've been looking for. So his overcoming the grave will establish his overcoming grace for the disciples and for us. He will be delivered over and killed. On the third day, he will rise. Jesus will be delivered over, killed, and on the third day, he will rise. He brings this up 5 times before it happens. So I hope you hear the gospel message and believe what he says, because if you do, you're coming in agreement with the Father and you're accepting his testimony that this is the Son of God, the one he sent to save us. So we now know who the Christ is. It's Jesus of Nazareth. You've been looking for him, he says to the ladies, the angel says to the ladies, but he's not here, he's risen. What amazing news. He has life. He has true life, healthy life, healing life, fulfilling life, and of course, eternal life. And he offers it to everybody. Think of the woman caught in adultery, right? Can you imagine how terrified she was in the Bible? We talk about this one, where she's brought before Jesus and they want to stone her to death. She knows that she was caught in adultery. She's about to get stoned to death. I can't imagine the fear getting dragged into this public square. And by the end, Jesus says, hey, you who are guilt, without guilt, cast the first stone. And I love it because it starts with the older and the wiser. It says, starting with the older ones, one by one, they put down their rocks and they walked away. And he said, woman, has anyone condemned you? No, neither do I. What grace turnaround. The woman at the well experienced Jesus give her a grace-made turnaround. The woman caught in adultery experienced Jesus giving her a grace-made turnaround. He didn't come with guilt. He didn't come with shame. He came with grace. And then you've got Matthew, one of my favorite stories. I love the calling of Matthew because I just played it out in my mind a million times. And you've got him, he says he's sitting there in his tax collecting booth. We know he's disliked. You know the story about tax collectors. They're considered sinners in the Bible. Nobody likes Matthew. And all we have in the context from the scriptures is in the book of Matthew, Jesus walks up to the tax collector's booth. He looks at Matthew, the guy nobody likes. He says, you, follow me. Follow me. And Matthew just goes. He drops everything. He leaves all his papers on his desk. He walks into the street. He follows Jesus. And he does the next thing he knows what to do. Has him over his house. And who shows up? Everybody who would not show up to the scribes and Pharisees' houses. But they showed up with Jesus because they wanted to be with their buddy Matthew. And Jesus had just told Matthew, you can follow me. Matthew, again, was the product of a grace-made turnaround by this Jesus. He's awesome. He's the author of grace and he is the author of life. And we follow such an amazing God. So we have the message, and now we have the instruction, follow me. But the angel has specific instructions in this text, which is going to just seal the deal on this sermon with Peter, right? Okay, so back to chapter 16, verse 7 and 8. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. He's been saying it all along. This is how it's going to go. Here it's going to happen now. They went out and they fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized the women, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. They were just freaked out. That's the fact. They went running, speechless. But here's the fun thing in the text hidden in there. Go tell his disciples and Peter. Why is that so significant? Because Mark worked hand by hand with Peter in his ministry. So when John Mark was writing out his gospel, we can be confident Peter was in the room with him, helping him know what to say. And they were working together. He had John Mark write it. And here he has his name put in, which almost sounds selfish. Okay, we have Peter who wants to make sure he says he's going to reveal himself to the disciples and Peter. But it was a redeeming fact that Mark wanted to put in Peter's name, and Peter was okay with it. Why? Because just a couple days earlier, the scribes and Pharisees recognized Peter as a follower of Jesus Christ. And when they came to Peter, they said, "You follow that Jesus, don't you?" Peter was so afraid, he denied Christ. Right? That would be one of the most horrible things. Peter, it was like Peter had a gun to his head and they said, "Are you with Christ or not?" And Peter said, "No." He failed the test. He denied Christ when his life was on the line. And now Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. And the angel makes the announcement that guess what? Jesus is still going to reveal himself to Peter. Can you imagine how emotional that must have been for Peter? Gun to his head, he denied Christ and failed. And yet when the Christ resurrects, he says, "Guess what? It wasn't up to you, Peter, to pull that off in that moment. It was up to me, and I've already done it because I know where your heart is really at. And you will not be judged for that moment where you failed and you denied me." And so he said, so he wants him and John Mark find this so significant because the angel says, go and tell the disciples and Peter, because even the one who denied him in his fear is still going to be saved because Jesus does not fail. And he knows Peter's true heart. I can't imagine how emotional that must have been for Peter to hear the angel say, "He's going to reveal himself to you too, Peter. Don't worry about that. That was a bad day, but Jesus has got you safe." My friends, we hear the message, we follow Jesus, and we give hope-filled grace to everyone we meet because it was the Jesus way. And then we worship God. We just worship God with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind. Because when we turn to God, believing in the work of Christ to overcome the grave, we don't have to overcome anything. It's not up to us. We just trust Christ to overcome the grave. We then surely receive his overcoming grace, which is the secret sauce to every turnaround you'll ever need. Think about that. When we turn to God, believing in the work that Christ did to overcome the grave, we simply receive the gift of his overcoming grace. Believe in the risen Christ who has overcome the grave so you may have this overcoming grace. Happy Easter. There's a lot to be very happy about. Believe in the risen Christ who has overcome the grave as you receive his overcoming grace. Dear Jesus, we love you a lot and we are so grateful for what you have done. These words are so rich and so powerful. It's just so much to try to even communicate. But Lord, your salvation is so sure that even Peter, who denied you in the face of his fear, you didn't let him go. You loved him too much. And we pray for the salvation of everybody in this room, that we would believe in the work of the risen Christ, knowing that he has our life and his route is the best route from now and into eternity. We believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. He has risen. He is risen indeed. Amen and amen.
Please stand and join with us as we respond in song to what we just heard.
On the cross of Calvary, he declares his work is finished. He has spoken this hope to me. Though the sun has ceased its shining, though the war appeared as lost, Christ has triumphed over evil. It was finished upon that cross. Now the curse, it has been broken. Jesus paid the price for me. For the pardon he has offered, great the welcome that I receive. Boldly I approach my Father, clothed in Jesus' righteousness. There is no more guilt to carry. It was finished upon that cross. Was once my great opponent. Fear once had a hold on me. But the Son who died to save us rose that we would be free indeed. And death was once my great opponent. Fear once had a hold on me, but the Son who died to save us rose that we would be free indeed. Yes, he rose that we would be free indeed. Free from every plan of darkness, free to live and free to love.
Amen. Hey, good news. God has your grace made turnaround ready for you. You just need to trust Jesus. And listen to these words. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, he'll do this. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord before all ages, now and forever. Amen and amen. Happy Easter. Ugh.
redeemed.